Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Primetime at the BU Library. Primetime at BU Library's mission is to encourage lifelong learning beyond the classroom for faculty, students, and staff through presentations by the Edmund Scholars Faculty and Student Research Teams, Faculty Excellence Award winners, Student Study Abroad Spotlights like this one today, Not Ready for Primetime and Ready for Primetime faculty presentations, Talk About Teaching, and for the students here, the Library Research Prize winner presentation, which is a $250 cash prize for your research that uses library resources. There's more information on the library website about this, and the deadline is February 1st. Michelle and Talia's presentation today is co-sponsored by the Office of Off-Campus Programs in International Studies and the Friends of the BU Library. On Thursday, November 18th, Dave Rosa from Career Services will be speaking about advising partnerships, connecting students with career services. For our presentation today, we welcome Talia Carmickle and Michelle Turner talking about their experiences in France and Guatemala.
So as you can see, I'm Michelle.
And I'm Talia.
Good. And our topic today is about diverse cultures with a unifying transformation. And so we'll just be going through our separate experiences, but the similarities that we found kind of in both of them. Alright, I'll be starting. I spent a semester in Paris, France. I spent it in Paris, France. The program that I went through was Global Learning Semester, so it was not with Bethel. A funny part about it was actually the Super Bowl, while I was gone, had a commercial sponsored by Google about studying abroad in Paris, and Global Learning Semesters was like the first search item, and we all freaked out when we were abroad, so that was fun. Spring of 2010 is when I went on it, and why or what was the intention? The intention was to go abroad to learn a new language. I did not know any French when I was accepted. Kind of wanted to go over and hit the ground running. My classes were in English, and the school that I attended was an international school, so that meant the students there were from all over, from Paris, from Mexico, from Brazil. And I just really loved the conversations that I was able to have with them. Pictures in here, this is the Bastille, which is in Paris. These are two of my roommates before we knew how to fit in Paris, as you can tell. they're the colorful ones walking around amidst all the black. This is one of my roommates, Sam, and I over in Rome when we were taking our spring break. The company I went with, Global Learning Semester, also had two excursions. With one, we went to the Côte d'Azur, so the south of France. And this is when our bus driver was pretending to be a professional photographer. Oh, look this way, love the camera. And so we're just cracking up. And this is when we went to Manet's garden, which was also beautiful. So that's kind of about the brief of my semester.
And last spring, I studied abroad in Guatemala on Bethel's Guatemala term. There were 18 of us in the group, and that included our leader and three students from Northwestern College in Iowa, and the rest of us were Bethel students. We were divided up into roommate pairs, and the first week and the last 3 weeks, we lived in a small rural town called Magdalena, and then the rest of the time, we did a home. That was with a homestay, and then the rest of the time we did a homestay in a city called Antigua. During my time there, we were closely connected with Students International, which is a Christian missions organization, and their staff is half American and half Guatemalan, and they work in sites within the community in Magdalena. They work in the clinic, in a school, an art school. There was a microfinance site, and an agriculture site, and there are two social work sites as well. And I spent 3 weeks at each of those. The first was called Hermano Pedro, and that was a hospital that houses 200 patients with physical and or mental disabilities. And while we were there, we just spent time being with the patients, whether that was just sitting with them or giving them rides in their wheelchairs or just sitting with them in their school and helping them do crafts and work on their fine motor skills. We also help serve lunch every day. And then the last 3 weeks, I shadowed a social worker in a resettlement community off of Magdalena called El Gorion. And there we helped in a school, and we helped with the clinic every Thursday. And then we also just went around and talked to different people. The social worker there does a lot of resource coordination within the community and has just started doing clinical social work and reconciling the relationships that are there. We also invited all the community members to a banquet that Students International held for the community members of El Gorion, based on the banquet that Jesus talked about in the Bible of inviting those who cannot give back. The rest of the time we attended language school in Antigua, and we did 2 4-week sessions, and that was one-on-one with a Guatemalan teacher. We also had a third world economics class with Dr. Zalanga here at Bethel over Skype, and we also had a cross-cultural class with a man who has lived in Guatemala for 30 years.
Next, we just want to talk about the importance of language and the similarities between our two experiences that we found. I definitely learned to appreciate English when I was abroad. I was lucky enough to have my classes in English, but everywhere else, French, French, French. They don't want us to know French. There were definitely deeper conversations I was able to have because I knew English, but some of the restrictions about French were, French in France is something that really unifies the country over there and brings them together. Better French is a sign of better education and really helps you out in the societal realm. We were lucky enough to have a crepe store right outside our apartment, which was fabulous, but the men there didn't know English very well, so it'd be fun sometimes when I would talk to them. There was one incident when the volcano in Iceland had just exploded, and I just wanted to share my excitement with them about world news and what have you. Of course, I'm limited vocabulary. So I go up to them and I go, vous en tout de la boom. And of course, they just look at me, très interessante. So that was very fun. But there were other moments definitely when I would attempt French and be interrupted midway through. It was definitely, again, something that they took very, very importantly. And sometimes it would just be my pronunciation that they would like to correct. So there was a lot of humility that I experienced on myself when I was learning the language, and then also patience that I got to understand. When other people, some of my my classmates who were Parisian or Mexican or Brazilian who were speaking English to me, so patience for them, and then also I feel like patience now that I'm back here in the U.S. for people who are also trying to learn the language. So that was a cool side of the experience of studying abroad.
For Guatemala term, we did sign a contract. That said, that we would speak Spanish basically the whole time that we were there. This did not happen all the time within our group. But I really appreciated English while I was there. And just what a comfort English was when I just needed to express myself on a deeper level. And I really gained an appreciation for immigrants and refugees who come to the United States and speak another language and are supposed to function in English here. But I really just learned what a comfort my first language is. And as two of the American staff members would say within Students International, that sometimes you just need to speak in the language of your heart, which for all of us was English. And also with that, my definition of fluency definitely changed while I went to language school and did my homestays. Before I left, I thought that if you were fluent in a language, you would just be able to communicate with a native speaker. However, now I realize that there are so many just different words and different sayings and ways of speaking that all contribute to fluency. And so in the picture right here, that's me with my second language teacher, Nancy. And she was just very patient with me as I learned Spanish, and she was very patient as I would be talking about something and she'd have no clue what I was saying, or you just kind of figure it out. And then also I was able to experience cultures beyond the host culture that I was in through the different housemates that came to my house in Antigua. We had housemates from the United States, Canada, Belgium, the Netherlands, Costa Rica, and Japan. This is my roommate and I with our housemate from Japan. Her name is Mihoko. And we would eat all of our meals with all of our different housemates. And so that was just really interesting to see how their cultures were affecting how they experienced Guatemala. And then also English was usually the common language among all of us. Except when Mihoko came, because she didn't speak very much English or Spanish, and so we would just bounce back and forth between the two languages and lots of charades. So.
Next, we're talking about relationships that we both had. I'm going to be semi-brief with relationships because a lot of them intertie with faith, which is the next aspect. But quick stories would be relationships. One of the relationships that I really appreciate while I was abroad was just with the church and the people there that I became connected with. I didn't find them right away, but once I found a church body, I joined a small group, which was every other week, and then on the various weeks there was kind of like a discussion education night with the Bible, which was really interesting. And so I really appreciated those services. Were both in French and English, so I really got to experience more of the language there. These are three of my friends from church. Claudia, who is from Mexico, John, who is from Australia, and then Chiesda, who is from England. I would go to later on as the seasons became nicer, I started doing some of their sport activities with them, and these were activities where primarily only French-speaking people went, so that really tested me, where these guys are kind of from all over, the people who went to the sports events. We're playing handball here. I had to sit out. I was like, fatigue. I'm like, oh, come on. I was like, oh, let me go. Another relationship I have up here is Joan. Joan was our downstairs neighbor in the apartment that we were set up with our program. And she was just marvelous. She was an Indian woman from England who had all this amazing experience from being a teacher in Mexico to working with the United Nations to being an independent journalist. And she helped us tremendously. There was one morning where our electricity almost went out. And if any of you know anything about the French people, they only come back when it's convenient for them, so it would have been disaster. And she saved us just in time. We had 2 hours to get in contact with, Carl, our site director, and saving electricity. It was like 8 o'clock in the morning, which, for those in Paris, it's early. And so all of my roommates are hustling and bustling, taking advantage of the last, what they think to be the last hot showers, and she just helped us out so much with that conversation, and I ended up having a really good conversation with her afterwards when I went over to say thank you. And last but not least are my roommates. They were all American girls from the United States, obviously American United States. Just getting to know them day by day. These are a few of the other students who went to our school. We had a Mexican dinner one night, which was like so great, guacamole. But just the small adventures that we had to get together was really amazing.
Relationships were also very important in Guatemala. I learned a lot about the power of relationships just through observing my different site leaders at Hermano Pedro. My two site leaders were Nanette and Marianela. Nanette is the top picture on the right. She's second from the left, and then Marianela is on the right. And I just loved watching them every day interact with the patients and just seeing the relationships that they had. And just seeing From the moment they entered the door, just how much love they had for the patients and how much the patients loved them and just how much joy they brought into each other's lives. And I just loved seeing the ability that they had to see beyond the disabilities and beyond the wheelchairs to the person within and the humanity within. And I just learned a lot from that. And then also just observing my site leader, Nick, in El Gorion, and just how he interacted with the people and just seeing the relationships that he had built with all the community members and how he had taken time to learn from them about their lives and the way that they operate. And just to see the trust that he had built with each of them was very cool. The person that I learned the most from in Guatemala was a beautiful woman named Vida. And she's in the second picture with my roommate and I. She was actually the maid at my house in Antigua, which I was not expecting to have a maid while in Guatemala. But she lived at the house Monday morning through Saturday afternoon, and then she would go home every weekend to just go home and see her family. And she also had a daughter who was a year and a half who lived with her family during the week. My roommate and I decided that we were going to help her with the dishes after lunch and dinner every day. And so during that time, we just spent doing dishes in the kitchen with her, and we were able to just talk to her and just build a relationship with her. And it grew to having her eat dinner with us sometimes, and we took her out to ice cream a couple of times, which was a very cool experience because in Guatemala, food is relationship, and so it was really cool to be able to share those times with food and just share a conversation and get to know her better. And it was really cool to see her trust us more and more throughout our 2.5 months there. A lot of her perspectives are very different from my experiences. And one way in which my perspectives changed as a result of her was when she was talking about her brother who lives in Denver, and that's where I'm from. And so I kind of freaked out and asked her what he does, and he is a construction worker. And it really hit me that he was just that whole story really hit me because so many times my own family has had construction done on our home, and we just make jokes about, oh, the Mexicans are here to work again. And just realizing that those men might not be from Mexico, they may be from Guatemala or another Central American or South American country, and they have families and they have stories, and that just really hit me. And then the last point I have is just my group. I had a fantastic group in Guatemala. There are 18 of us, so that's a large group, but it was just a beautiful group of people. And one girl from my group one day said that our group really exemplified the body of Christ. And I just loved how she said that. And because we all have such different personalities and giftings, but we were able to blend together so well to encourage one another. And we were able to have fun with one another, but at the same time, through that language of our heart, we were able to be real and deep with one another and challenge each other on issues of faith and the things that we were seeing and experiencing throughout our time in Guatemala.
Okay, so next is Faith, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about my roommates, but to do so, I'm going to read a little section from the journal that I kept when I was abroad. So when I was there, my roommates, first impression, my roommates were a different type of person, class of their own than I was. They all had coach purses. I had totally forgotten to bring any nighttime attire. none of my direct family were planning on visiting me, just different life experiences and what have you. And so because of this, I as much as I tried to love them as equals, I had a lot of pride issues in not being able to love them as equals. And I had this experience. There was a morning, again, just a lot of placing myself above them because I felt I was more, maybe morally righteous or what have you. It's just really kind of tough walls to overcome. But there was a morning when I came down and a boy had slept over again. And this is my experience, I said. Anyways, to catch up, the other day, this boy slept over again, and this time without with his jeans off and shirtless. I don't know if anything happened, but at first I was upset, and I didn't know how to act. I walked into the bathroom, and I stood there staring into the mirror. Growing up, I feel as though I have been conditioned to feel put off to such things, and furthermore, the people who take part in them, almost with a, I don't agree with what you're doing, mentally sort of line. But then I stood there, longer, and I thought to myself, how did Jesus treat people, and how would he respond? And that's when it hit me. Jesus did not have a conditional love. People's various range of actions did not impact his love towards them. It also hit me that such action, although commonly frowned upon in the church society, should have no impact at all regarding how I treat that person. Tax collectors and prostitutes were frowned upon by society, and that did not stop Jesus one bit. He did not say, oh, I do not agree with what you are doing, I'm uncomfortable with your actions, so take care. No. He acted in ways others wouldn't. I feel even the church at that time and even today wouldn't, and loved them, not despite this or that or what have you, but because he loved them. This was a humbling reality I'm just beginning to understand. I don't know why it has taken so long. And actually, it wasn't until 2 months later that I even better understood how comparing myself to them was kind of an unjust comparison. I wrote this as a God-given understanding. Again, this is 2 months afterwards. And I say, comparing oneself to others is a cheap and unrealistic wanted justification and distraction. Christ should be the only one we are comparing our lives to. And when we do this, we will only ever be humbled. And it demolishes some pride because to him we will never live up. Just being abroad really kind of shattered my stereotypes and judgments that I put on people, because sin can be from sexual immorality to judgmentalness, and it just has a whole range. And so just becoming aware of that. And it was really amazing because at this time I, again, was looking for a church and looking for encouragement to love these people as I felt they deserved it. And the first education night I went to was all about the love of God and how it's unconditional and we can't stop it, and it kind of defines all rules. And that was just a neat encounter and timing on God's part. But other things regarding my roommates, this is my entire group, by the way, were that they would even encourage me. I was pretty consistent in going to church. And I became, as I said, a part of a small group, and there was one night where I was second-guessing it, and actually one of my roommates encouraged me. She goes, when you return from there, you are just so enlightened, like, you are just so glowing, almost, and I did not expect that in the least, and so that was quite encouragement to hear that from my friends and my roommates. None of them were Christian, but they all had interaction with the church, and actually over the semester, it was really amazing because there would be times where we would either be walking one-on-one or with a group, and sometimes they would just kind of come to me by themselves and ask me questions about faith, and to be able to be someone that they would trust to speak into their life was just an amazing experience and such a blessing. This is my cousin, who I also had good faith talks with, and I never really had that. So, yeah, those are kind of my big faith things, I guess.
When I went to Guatemala, I had no idea what I was getting myself into, but I did want to go in with open eyes, an open mind, and an open heart to the things that I would be seeing and experiencing. So this required a level of vulnerability. Our first Bible study in Guatemala was within the first couple of weeks. And my site leader, Nick, who is in the top picture on the right, and his wife, Maureen, led the Bible study. And they just really encouraged us to ask questions about anything and everything that we were going to experience in Guatemala throughout our semester. And that ended up becoming a huge lesson for me. And I learned that it is okay and it is a good thing to ask questions. And so while I was in Guatemala, I basically deconstructed my faith and started the process of rebuilding it. And that could be a process that continues for the rest of my life, but, and I'm definitely still in the phase of asking a lot of questions. Those questions started the very first week I was there when I was serving in Hermano Pedro, which is the building on the bottom right. And I just had a lot of questions there and working in El Gorion where poverty is very prevalent. About why are there disabilities and why is there poverty and whether God is actually good or not. And I also just realized how much Christianity is rooted in culture. And I realized how much the way that I have approached my faith and read the Bible in the past has been from a position of privilege and power. And just being in Guatemala and having so many chances to ask Nick questions and talk to him and my other group members, being offered a fresh perspective on the Bible and just trying to see the Bible through a different set of eyes and through the eyes of the people that I was meeting. And just really learning and seeing that Jesus was all about justice and that God is a God of justice. Even if I don't always understand. And so, I don't
know. I think just in closing, we just want to wrap up that I think both of our experiences led us to be more open-minded and willing for conversation and discussion regarding alternative perspectives or what have you.
We were both transformed.
But definitely the experience. I don't know how many of you have studied abroad, but you have. But not to discourage you, transformation can take place at Bethel or wherever you are. For us, it just took maybe getting outside this environment and into another, whether that be both culturally and in our faith and et cetera, to really engage in issues we didn't have to before.
Mm-hmm. And willing to be vulnerable.
Yeah. But I think otherwise we just kind of wanted to open up these last minutes for questions, if you guys had any.
So was your cousin in France?
My cousin studied in Munich for a year and visited me.
Oh,
okay. So that was really fun.
Yeah.
Okay. I might have missed this. What are your future plans now?
Okay, you want to change your direction.
Well, I don't really know yet. That's definitely a process that I'm in right now, is trying to figure out how my experiences from Guatemala are going to affect the decisions that I make as graduation quickly approaches. And just how I'm going to live my life with Guatemala behind me now.
For me, I would say I'm majoring in business and marketing with an art history minor. But I realized just how much I love conversations about faith or other experiences and community. And while you can definitely find that in the marketing world, other items that I engaged in while I was abroad, I found a book club while I was abroad and was able to go to that multiple times. And it was just primarily older women, but from all over, whether it be New Zealand or England or Paris or Russia. And that was really interesting, getting to connect with them and read great books. And another thing I was able to attend while abroad was a philosophy cafe conversation at a nearby cafe. And again, engaging in discussions and questions. And that one was about hope and fear in regards to the government and society, and just really interesting things. And it's kind of pushed me to think, I might not go into marketing. But that's all right, and it's just kind of, I think I definitely discovered a lot more about myself while I was abroad, and I don't know if that means going into the humanities or literature or what have you, but just also seeing these other passions in me that I wouldn't have been confronted with or engaged with otherwise. So,
yeah. Thank you for sharing your stories with us. I was deeply moved by your open and honest description of the low points that mm-hmm. you encountered and through which that you also reached the high point. Mm-hmm. And I am very, very grateful for that. To what extent you are able to help your family and relatives understand what has happened to you? Mm-hmm. You mentioned about transformation from yes. the low points to the high points. Yes. To what extent you were able to communicate with them what happened to you personally and theologically?
My family back at home.
Yes.
Ooh. Okay. My family and I definitely had weekly Skype dates after talks on their behalf. And I've shared with them quite a bit. I've already shared with them my change in future jobs or future passions and etc. I don't know how much I shared with them regarding all the low points, because those are very vulnerable, and while my family and I are close, I don't know how much I shared with them. Transformation, I think they could see it grow in me as we talked from week to week, and the conversations that we picked up and the points that I brought across to them. Transformation, I think it'd be interesting for me to sit down and talk with them about what they saw in me, and then also discuss back with them more of the low points and high points that happened in me. So I think that's a conversation to be had.
Thank you.
With the different categories you identified, like faith and language and relationships, were those things you were really aware of when you were there, or is it just after coming back you were able to look back on your experiences and say these are really high points and things that made an impact on
me? I would say that I was very aware of all of those things while I was there, because we were supposed to be speaking Spanish all the time, and we were with people all the time, and we were talking about faith all the time. but I think that I've realized since coming back the impact that those things have had on me, and just kind of stepping back and seeing more of the bigger picture of how all of my experiences impacted me.
And for me, I definitely saw those things being interplayed while I was over there. It was like a constant juxtaposition day in, day out, whether that was I'm living around these girls, but I'm going to church twice a week and becoming in a relationship with them, being from school where all the classes are in English to out on the town where French is what you should speak and at least attempt to speak. And I think just like Talia, it was, obviously I was processing a lot while over there, but it wasn't, I don't think I maybe saw all the meaning in these four aspects until I was forced more to kind of work through them back here. Mm-hmm.
Talia, you mentioned the recognition of the privilege that you have. How has that impacted who you are, or how you think, or what you do now?
I think a lot about just where I come from and the decisions that I should be making and how to live my life. And just keeping in mind that there are people both here and around the world that are living in poverty. But I think that's still a process that I'm still in and figuring out how exactly that affects me. But I think it was very humbling and I think it has caused me to want to be more open to just listening to other people and placing myself, if not lower, but at their level.
What was the culture shock like going there and then also the reentry coming back?
Okay. culture shock. It's funny because I feel like as I was about to leave for Paris, my friends were more aware of it than I was. It wasn't until I took a bike ride and was able to see so much of it in one trip that it really hit me. Culture shocks also included being friendly to everyone and saying hello to the French camp had this thing where you're respectful to other people if you respect their space. And a lot of times that comes off as the rude French and the snobbish French, but it's very polite and very respectful to not be in their way all the time. As far as coming back, one of the major culture shocks, again, was just realizing that, but also it's funny to look at the workloads that we have sometimes. Over in France, we had each class once a week, and so much time for exploring and these conversations that I've been talking about, and like a roommate and I would have Tuesday walks, and I would have items on Wednesday to go to, and workload, and finding time for relationships now, because I know the power and the significance of them after being abroad, not that I didn't beforehand, but just more so, and finding time for that amongst the different environments, especially now back at Bethel with a lot more, was a big one for me.
I would say culture shock both ways. I think just the whole Spanish aspect was a huge shock after 2 weeks there. It's just a lot of little things that kind of all add up. And especially doing homestays, there's a lot of different things that kind of add up and hit you after a while. Coming back, I think it was really difficult because I had all of these experiences and people at home didn't necessarily understand or, and it was really difficult coming back to Bethel too. Just because it's such a different environment than it was studying abroad.
What makes the environment so different?
Honestly, when I was coming back, I really felt like I was re-entering an atmospheric bubble. And I know we joke about the Bethel bubble, but it was very apparent to me when I came back this fall. I don't know, I just felt like where I had been the last semester was so different from my other semesters here, and I felt like I learned so much and I didn't necessarily know what to do with everything that I had learned while back here.
Maybe with that, we will wrap up. But thank you so much for coming today and listening to what we have to say. And just, we really enjoyed your time here as well. It's been a good time for us to process. So thank you so much.